Good afternoon, and thank you for joining our second of four Talk of the Town series discussions. I'm Adrienne Keeling with the City of Carmel's Department of Community Services. We are hosting this series as a part of the comprehensive plan update process. Our current comprehensive plan, many of you know, is called the C3 plan, was adopted in 2009 and has served us well for more than a decade. As growth and investment in our city continues, we as a city also need to focus on the future. And one of the best ways to do that is to regularly evaluate our policies and goals alongside best practices in the areas of growth, land use, transportation, and the environment. Leading our discussion this afternoon are representatives from Greenstreet and YARD Company, who have teamed up to help us update our comprehensive plan. We encourage you to enjoy your lunch. And now I'm going to turn it over to Kevin Wright of YARD Company to kick off today's discussion. Move in, not out.
All right. Thank you, Adrienne. And welcome everyone to Talk of the Town. As Adrienne mentioned, my name is Kevin Wright. I'm a principal and co-founder at YARD Company. We are an urban growth firm based out of Cincinnati that has been commissioned with our partners at Greenstreet, an Indianapolis-based real estate development and consulting firm, to update Carmel's comprehensive plan. What is a comprehensive plan and why are we here and talking about it today, you might be asking? Well, part of our role is, as part of this series, is to demystify some of the typical planning language used in a process like this. So in this case, the City of Carmel and the Department of Community Services has hired our team because they need to update many aspects of the city's comp plan. This update will help to refine goals related to growth for the next 10 years. And to put 10 years in a bit of perspective, since a lot has happened in the last decade, since the last drafting of the comp plan in 2008, we have seen the near universal adoption of smartphones, which has, among other things, led to the rise of apps for deliveries and mobility. We've seen a spike in the baby boomer population. We've seen two significant economic recessions, the most recent of which was brought on by the COVID-19 pandemic. Amidst all of this, though, Carmel has been doing very well. We have made significant changes to the physical environment that has made it attractive to new employers and residents. The growth of city center and improvements of the Monon Trail through a new midtown has established a strong urban core. The city has in many ways begun to grow up instead of out. This emerging pattern of redevelopment is necessitating a refreshed look at mobility, public spaces, mixes of uses, urban densities, and resilience, both economically and environmentally. These are some of the primary objectives inherent to this comprehensive plan update. Talk of the Town, which you're participating in today, is a four-part virtual series where we will be discussing different aspects of the comp plan and how issues such as mobility and land use might be updated in a way that continues to propel Carmel forward in a positive way. While we will be talking about how these issues relate to Carmel, we will also be providing case studies and examples from other places as necessary from across the country in an effort to help you visualize changes and better understand how they might get applied here to Carmel. This is the second of four Talk of the Town events. We will be holding these virtual events bi-weekly, continuing through April 9th. Each of these four webinars will be recorded and posted online so that stakeholders can view them on their own time and share them with their friends and neighbors. So before we dive in, a little bit of housekeeping for today. Please feel free to ask questions via the Q&A feature at any time, and we will do our best to answer these questions during the session. If we do not get to the questions, we will answer them and post them on the project website, which is housed at carmeldocs.com, carmeldocs.com, which is the home website for the Department of Community Services. And there's a link there for the comp plan project page. If you are watching a recorded version of this, then please leave your questions in the comment section of the website, Facebook, YouTube, whichever it might be, where you are viewing the video. And we will answer your question on that website or on the project website. If you don't have a question, but only a comment, that's fine. Leave that as well and we'll log it, take it into consideration and as we work to develop the update to the comp plan. So let's get started. Last week, our topic was leverage your own gravity. And during that webinar, we talked a lot about how Carmel has grown from a bedroom suburb of downtown Indianapolis's job center to become the second largest job center in the state. And what that has meant for growth in the last 10 years and what it means for growth for the next 10 years. This week's topic is move in, not out, as Adrienne said, and addresses the question of what happens when we can no longer create more land. In the past, Carmel could annex our way out of growth constraints, but that is no longer the case. As Carmel approaches build out of its remaining green space, recent commercial and mixed use development have revealed a new trend. Denser redevelopment that provides a higher property value per acre, vibrancy and walkability in key commercial areas. This reality is causing us to bump into each other more frequently, fill in the gaps to redevelop parcels and sketch out new possibilities for land currently encumbered by parking lots, extensive street rights of way, and buildings that have become obsolete. This will not only create more density, but place new demands on where and how we accommodate a mix of uses, how we use our transportation services, the types of amenities we require, and the character and brand needed to bring it all into a human scale reflective of the evolving Carmel story. So with that, I'm gonna hand it off to Mark to get us started. But first, we had a fun trivia question in the waiting room. The question was, since 2010, Carmel has permitted the development of how many new dwelling units? Was it A, 3,478, B, 5,789, or C, 8,363? The answer was C. And since 2010, a total of 8,363 new dwelling units have been permitted. This has led to an increased population of 20,000 people approximately. More than half of those have been multifamily units, and about a little over 4,000 have been single family or townhome style units. So Mark, I'm gonna use that to hand it off to you to start talking to us about how that trend we think will continue over the next 10 years and how it should apply to our thinking as a community around the comp plan.
Great, thanks Kevin, thanks Adrienne, thanks everyone for joining us. So to kick off this theme of move in, not out, wanted to talk a little bit about land supply. So on the left there, you can see as our current growth trajectory in Carmel began back in the 70s, you know, Carmel was still very much on the edge of the metro area, still very much a rural community. And at the time, auto-oriented development patterns meant where we lived and shopped and worked could all be spaced apart with plenty of buffers, because really there was nothing but farmland between Carmel and Kokomo. And that was reflected in land use regulations. You know, we spaced out everything because we could, and that was part of the draw. So, you know, minimum lot sizes and unit sizes and building coverage and lot coverage requirements really kind of went hand in hand with that. And, you know, if we built 100 new houses in Carmel, we ate up more land back then than we do now. And so that kind of moved along development along the periphery of Carmel and that utilized and maybe sped up, you know, the development of these farmlands back in the 70s and 80s and 90s. Of course, today, you know, things have changed, as we all have seen. You know, that trivia question is an interesting point. And on the pie graphs there, you can see in the decade 2000-2010, only about a quarter of the units built were multifamily or, you know, denser housing units. But that's already switched for a few reasons, you know, coming out of the Great Recession. But here in the last decade, that bumped up to more than half of the units were multifamily. And the remainder were single family and townhomes as well. So then the picture on the right, you know, along the Monon with constrained land, that's really affected the shape of development. And so, you know, we're seeing a little bit more verticality and just getting more out of a constrained land supply and needing to be more efficient in how we develop things. And, you know, mixed just as a rule of thumb across Carmel, land with mixed uses on it, say retail and residential, has a higher assessed value, 2 to 3 times higher than parcels with just single use residential or commercial on it. And on the next slide, same thing goes for our public rights of way, where even the infrastructure and how we think about streets is reacting to a more constrained land supply. And we're asking more of our infrastructure, where stormwater management can sometimes even be paired with the trail or a pervious paver, parking lot, or other structures like that that are just getting more out of our constrained land, and trying to think about how to be fiscally responsible and more efficient in the development of our land. You know, property tax revenue is an important piece of making Carmel work. And so requiring more efficiency out of our development style makes it easier to continue to provide services and collect more revenue per acre and build less road relatively and less pipes and wires and everything else relatively per unit.
So as Mark mentioned, this comprehensive plan isn't just a hypothetical or theoretical look at what's going to happen over the next 10 years. In many cases, it's reflecting trends and phenomena that are already well entrenched and are likely to continue to grow as a factor of the city's growth. And when we think about this trend of moving in, not out, it's already manifesting itself in a variety of ways. And I think it's helpful for the discussion if we just categorize them into three broad buckets. The first is additions and remodels. So taking an existing building or an existing property and somehow adding to it or reconfiguring it for new market needs, new requirements of the users, new design and aesthetic preferences, so on and so forth. The second is infill development. So in a rapidly growing city, there are pieces of property or whole sections of the city that have been leapfrogged over or for whatever reason have not developed. And in those cases, as market forces accelerate and become, look harder at those more difficult to develop pieces of property, infill development fills in the missing teeth in the city's urban fabric. And then lastly, redevelopment. This is usually taking place on a larger scale where we're taking fragments of our previous areas of development, such as industrial or agricultural uses, and reimagining and rebuilding them to meet today's needs and demands. So let's take a look at each one of these in a little more detail. So the first is additions and remodels. Now, Carmel, as it incrementally built out over the last few generations, has built an incredible wealth of diversity in terms of its architecture and building types. And when we look at its houses, many of these styles went out of style, in the years after World War II, but now are coming back in a big way. Your mid-century modern houses, for instance, the three on the right are examples, are seeing incredible market demand, not only for what they look like now, but how they can be adapted to meet today's needs. Other houses, such as old Victorian cottages, are getting added to for new garages or new living space. And retail is modifying its footprint to have more dining room space, or in light of the pandemic, really take advantage of outdoor space as part of a patio or dining area that can serve a restaurant. And speaking of the pandemic, one of the things that is really exerting a new pressure on houses in particular is the requirement to work at home. And many people have not only retrofitted their dining room table, but that extra bedroom or their den to be their workplace for most, if not all, of the week. But sometimes those pressures kick us out of our houses and we start looking elsewhere in our yards. And so people are looking at their garages and converting them into office space or workspace. And even now in the internet economy, you can get online and you can order what's called a studio shed, and it will show up to your house like a Lego kit on steroids and give you instructions for how to build your own 100 square foot office space in your backyard. And these things look pretty interesting as a piece of architecture unto themselves.
Building from those studio sheds even more is just a full-fledged mini home or granny flat or carriage house, certainly during the pandemic, but even before, as folks' housing needs have shifted and they're taking care of either, an aging parent or have a college kid come home, many of them have asked themselves, would it be nice to have, a separate guest unit in my backyard? Or in the basement or attached, you can see in the diagram there that they can take many forms. And these accessory dwelling units, as kind of the planning jargon calls them, have really provided a nice amount of flexibility through lifestyle and life cycle changes, but also just sometimes extra bit of revenue, weathering a recession or a pandemic. These just provide a little bit of flexibility. And certainly if there's space, they don't need to be sizable. These can be quite small.
So Mark, just to pause there and help the audience as we're thinking through how to influence some of the items you both have touched on through the comp plan. What are some considerations we should be thinking about as we do that, particularly with the images we see on the screen here and the diagram at the bottom with the granny flats, as we call them? What should we be thinking about as we consider permitting these in certain areas of the city?
You know, ideally, they don't visually need to have a significant effect. You know, we've zoomed in on them, so to speak, here in the photos, but if you're walking down a street or driving down a street, you probably won't notice any of these, or you'd really have to be looking for them and knew that they were there to notice that there's indeed an extra housing unit on the property. So I think just integrating them and thinking about character, you know, preserving larger trees or other parts of the landscape that continue to soften, you know, the adding, you know, what is adding a housing unit, but might not be adding any more people and doesn't need, you know, need to have a significant impact on the character or the feeling of the neighborhood.
Yeah. So in short, blend in.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, and speaking of blending in certain cases, when a new home buyer comes into a neighborhood and wants to live in that neighborhood, they can't find a house that meets all of their needs, but they can find a house that maybe they like the property or the location, and it is affordable to the extent that they can afford to buy the home, tear down most of it, if not all of it, and build back a new infill house on that piece of property. And when market pressures are like they are in Carmel, amidst land shortages and constraints at the periphery of town, coupled with the fact that people want to live in neighborhoods close to amenities like the Monon and city center or parks and schools, you're seeing a lot of cases where someone buys that house or that property, tears down the structure that's there, and builds back a new house with the goal of not only letting it meet its needs or creating something that meets that family's needs, but fits into the neighborhood and adds to the diversity and the scale and the texture of a place. And you can see the wide range of cases where that's happening in the city today, ranging from kind of in tight neighborhood lots all the way to more rural large lots at the edge of town. But homes, of course, aren't the only things that are changing. Retail is changing quite rapidly as well. And so what we're seeing that as options for retail become limited or the demands of them change, or small businesses, restaurants, and services want to be closer to their customers, we're actually seeing houses or house-like structures be converted into new uses and to serve new purposes closer to the neighborhoods and the people and their customers that they serve. And so you've got cases where houses become coffee shops or lawyers' offices, not in a strip mall or a commercial center or even downtown, but actually as part of the neighborhoods. And here you see a number of examples of where that's taken place on streets like Rangeline and Main Street. Now there's another interesting phenomenon that hasn't quite started in Carmel, but is likely to exert a greater influence as we look to the future as the city continues to grow. And this is a case where someone owns a house on a large lot, and they've decided that they want to either downsize or change their living arrangement, but they want to stay in the neighborhood. And they also realize that their land has inherent value because of its location and size. And so what that property owner may elect to do is to tear down their house, divide that large lot into two smaller lots, but lots that are still in context with the scale of the neighborhood, and build back a house for themselves, as well as a house to put back onto the market to sell to a new neighbor. And so oftentimes where we see this happen is along some of the major thoroughfares and at the edges of neighborhoods where the streets are generally larger and the setbacks are deeper. But this can be a valuable tool for incrementally allowing new households to form in neighborhoods while allowing a resident to capture the wealth that's been created by their property. Now, this is a really important thing to get right. It represents a change in the neighborhood. And so things like scale and design really start to matter. You can see in the images on the left and upper right where that scale has been attended to. But where that starts to get a little bit risky or problematic is where you see the image on the right, where we're trying to fit 20 pounds of sand into a 5-pound bag. And this is where design controls and keeping the quality level of this type of development high can really make sure that outcomes are working for everybody.
You know, similarly, at the neighborhood scale, if land prices are increasing and there's, you know, real estate pressures that Carmel is feeling now, that same kind of style where it's, you know, a house could be 3-4 bedrooms still, but on a smaller yard can make sense. In a pocket neighborhood, you know, we've seen these locally with Inglenook or similar developments really across the country. It's, you know, the home buyer in this case wants less lawn to mow, but they don't have to necessarily sacrifice garden or green space. And it's just making better use and, you know, flipping the design to a little bit more old fashioned, traditional, where the neighborhood is, you know, literally tighter knit, and it's easier to see someone on their porch across the street because things have just been tightened up. But it's largely a reflection of changing preferences and what people want on the demand side. And then the supply of land is constrained and prices are going up. So it's easier to squeeze a little bit more. And ideally, these are the sorts of developments that are near, you know, commercial centers and are easier to get on your bike or walk to a hub of amenities and services. And that kind of just gets back to what is, you know, a trendy term, this 20-minute neighborhood, but is really a timeless way of organizing cities and just bringing people's daily needs close by is basically all that is. The map you see there, it's called a walk score map, and it's just a heat map measuring where daily needs from shopping and services to churches and parks and schools are clustered. And really across the city, there are already commercial centers serving people and they are growing. You know, West Clay and on the west side and Legacy over on the far east, northeast corner of town are examples of newer commercial centers that continue to slowly build out, you know, serving the needs of people nearby. And it's just a nice way to organize investment in the future, that if we're going to spend more on infrastructure and make these streets and sidewalks work as a neighborhood center, then it makes sense to offer more housing options to people who do want to be near those sorts of centers. And so the kind of two ways to come at that is allowing housing to come in to formerly purely retail or commercial areas. You know, the greenest kind of blob on that map is Merchant Square, Gramercy area, just southeast of downtown, where there are a lot of services. So, you know, it wouldn't be surprising to see housing start to mix into areas like that. Or the reverse might be true in certain situations where commercial uses that just, you know, a restaurant or a small salon or something, a spa might make sense elsewhere in the city.
Well, and Mark, this really connects back to what Joe was talking about with adaptive reuse in some ways, right? This is sort of a gentle or soft way of starting to create 20-minute neighborhoods, is rethinking the use of buildings that were previously used in a different way. I think a couple of the pictures on the bottom there indicate that that's possible.
Right, and those same homes that could flip into a business and not significantly change the character of the street that they're on could, you know, one day go back to being a home. That's the advantage of more timeless kind of building structures as opposed to kind of the big box or single use retail buildings, just as an example that we've seen are harder to adapt.
Right. This is where when we talk about 20-minute neighborhoods, I think it's important to point out, and we are pointing out with these images, that it doesn't mean that we create these huge commercial centers with the large swaths of parking and single story, you know, 40,000 foot buildings. Go ahead, Joe.
No, you hit the nail on the head. This is another case where design really matters. That when we think, you know, oftentimes in conventional terms of commercial coming into our neighborhood, that it gives us pause, because so much has been baked into our zoning and building regulations to make retail and commercial and services and amenities look like the image on the upper right, which fits to a T those regulations, where we start imagining retail as having large parking lots with overhead lighting and traffic. And as we've seen in some of the images and stories that we've been telling today, that with the right design, that can really start to be a value add to the neighborhood. It can fit into the neighborhood. And as Mark mentioned, as needs change, can be adapted for a variety of purposes that sometimes are hard to predict.
And I do have a question that's sort of relevant, I believe, from Marga to the map, Mark. She says, just can you name some, she's saying, what are the east-west roads there? I'm assuming mm-hmm. you can see, well, she's talking about some of the ones in the, that are particularly in the higher walk score.
Right, so the Carmel label itself is on Main Street. The next major block of, north of that would be Smoky Row. And then of course the northern edge of the map is 146, you know, the edge of town, Clay Terrace and Lowe's. And then the green kind of continues down Rangeline, more or less down to about 116th Street. So that's kind of the greenest and yellowest spots we're seeing in the middle of the map.
Okay, great.
Well, and just to pick up on that thread about design, it really does matter as we start to move from an expansion mode into more people living in a less amount of area. And while in certain parts of the city, it makes a lot of sense to do large mixed use apartment buildings and multifamily or condo buildings, that makes sense in a lot of locations. In most locations, design of multifamily buildings or denser living need not be associated with big, bulky, or hulking developments. In fact, there are many cases where townhouses and attached dwelling units or multifamily and condo buildings can be designed to look like they were always part of the neighborhood, either as a large mansion that was divided up or as something that anchors a prominent corner in a neighborhood. And you can see examples of where on the left, these larger developments, these apartment buildings like the yellow and the white one are designed to fit into their neighborhood context, or patio homes, such as the middle bottom one that are two or three attached can look like bungalows that maybe already existed in the neighborhood, or townhouses in the blue. These things can be very pleasing additions to neighborhoods if the design and the form controls are set up correctly. Retail is the same way, and I don't need to really repeat this as we've covered it on the previous slide, but retail can be designed to either be standoffish and a nuisance to a neighborhood, or it can be designed to be complementary to the growth and the development in the neighborhoods around it.
You know, I think attractive retail, not only because retail is changing so quickly and, you know, what is the draw to these sorts of places, but it's inviting for some folks to live there. You know, Clay Terrace or other lifestyle centers like this certainly did something right when they were built initially, basically trying to mimic a Main Street sort of environment, at least in this case on a one or a two story scale. You know, parking was accessible and easy, but the landscaping and the layout is similar to a bit of a Main Street. And I think as retail has shifting forces on it, of course, you know, shifting online, the draw to a retail center is not as much the big department store as an anchor, but more and more programming, even in civic public space. And, you know, restaurants and food and beverage aren't going to switch to Amazon or shopping online. You know, people still want to gather and see and be seen. And so really building off that vibrancy that the retail strip centers are going to need to stay relevant also then makes them attractive to a hotel or to apartments or office space up above. And so we're seeing more and more across the country, and probably one day to Clay Terrace, where three or four or five story buildings might make a lot of sense as more people want to live or work or visit these places and continue to add relevancy and vibrancy to these centers throughout the day so that they can compete in this changing retail landscape. Of course, the greatest example, I think, here in central Indiana, we know really well is what's happened along the Monon has been really striking and standard setting, I think, for how to make the most of a great public space accessible to everyone, so that not only can folks of all ages, residents and visitors recreate here, bank headquarters and tech businesses want to locate here as well. And so adding to that vibrancy not only makes it an exciting heart and core for people to fall in love with, or to go on a first date and fall in love with someone at, but to just have this long-term view of how are we gonna make sure that when we spend money on public infrastructures and beautiful spaces like this, will they last? And it's really following timeless, tenets or principles of design to make them usable to a lot of people during lots of different situations all throughout the year, really.
Well, and just to connect to this next slide, we do have a comment or a question about, comment that they love the idea of the 20-minute neighborhood. A question is do we mean a 20-minute walk? We do mean a 20-minute walk. And as we answer that and hand it off here to the next slide, we've touched on over the course of all these slides here, this idea of commercial sort of uses starting to gently integrate into residential areas, residential starting to be included in what has historically been exclusively commercial areas. What does that mean, Joe, for how we get around? I mean, what is that going to look like in the next 10 years?
Right. And so when you are starting to bring people and their daily needs and destinations closer together, that certainly creates a different paradigm for traffic. While congestion is in a traditional a bedroom community is most associated with the AM and PM peak travel times when people are coming to and from work. When we live in a neighborhood or a city that has most of its daily needs or more of its daily needs closer to where we live, where you may live, work, go to school, pray, shop, all within 15 minutes of where you live, your times of day that you travel and how you travel is likely to change. And so already what we're seeing is people, rather than piling into the station wagon and driving to the next town over to go to brunch, piling onto their bikes, hopping on one of the 220 miles of bike paths that have already been built and are growing in Carmel, and biking to that local restaurant and enjoying that time together. Or people are walking more to school or being able to hop on a bike to work. All of these things are already starting to change, and it's starting to influence how we rethink streets and how we think about the future of our transportation system. And when we do that, what we often find is the greatest inhibitor to making that trip is when you're, particularly if you're making it by bike or by foot, is what that kind of missing gap is between getting from where you are to the kind of primary way that you're gonna get to your destination. You know, in our last conversation a couple weeks ago, we described how many people both live and work within a 1 mile distance of the Monon. Another way of putting that is if there was a enjoyable, safe, and convenient way for a person to get from their doorstep to the Monon, and then from the Monon to their office lobby, that they would be well connected to get from one to the other using the Monon, which is a best in class type bike facility and trail. And so we have to spend a lot of time thinking about what that last mile looks like, that missing link in a transportation system that can start to allow all of these trips to safely and conveniently happen. And so when we're doing that, we look at things like streets, how to augment the trail, path, and intersection design within the city, how to think about safety and regulations and enforcement, and also about the infrastructure at your destination. Do we have enough bike racks? If you're at your employer, do you have enough lockers for your bike or shower facilities to transition from your commute into where you're going to work? You know, one story that sticks with me from an accomplished and a pretty experienced bike rider in Carmel was that when he takes his family out to go to brunch or to a soccer game or something, and they want a bike there, they actually have to get in their car, put all the bikes on the car, drive to the Monon, and then take the bikes off, get on the Monon, and get to their destination. Wouldn't it be something if they could just roll out of their driveway onto a street, into a path system, and then connect to the Monon without even getting in the car at all? Those are some of the missing links that I think we have to start to address as we think about the next 10 years. Of course, one of the biggest obstacles when thinking about that experience of walking, biking, or spending time outdoors and getting to where we need to go is the comfort level of the environment itself. And one of the biggest offenders of that experience is a phenomenon we call heat islands, where we have large exposed surfaces, usually asphalt or concrete, that radiate a lot of the heat that hits them back up into the atmosphere and into the air, and really puts a lot of stress on us as we're trying to move about the public realm. And so as we look ahead to the future of our streets and our public spaces, start, and even the width of the pavements and amount of parking that we build without coverage, we really start to think about these comfort levels that are so important to how we move about town. And then there's transit. We're getting to the point in Carmel and the greater Indianapolis region where we have enough dense clusters of employment, of services, and of residential neighborhoods where transit is really starting to pencil out and really starting to become a choice and preferred mode of travel, getting from work to home and back, or to school, or to our daily needs. And when we think about the potential future of transit in Carmel, it is absolutely clear, because Carmel has put so much thought into other aspects for how you move around, that it's going to be a best-in-class experience. And we have seen models for how that can be done from around the country, where the whole experience from understanding when and where a transit vehicle can pick you up to the experience of purchasing a ticket, to getting on and off the vehicle, all of those little details are figured out. They're convenient, they're safe, they're reliable, and they add to the diversity of choices we have when we're making a decision about how to move around. And it also doesn't have to be a one-size-fits-all solution. We have seen a number of examples where it's just not the old clunky bus that comes and picks you up every hour from down the street, where we're seeing on-demand services, even in things like golf carts, come to your front door, pick you up, and take you where do you want to go. Or on in a corporate campus, a shuttle system that takes people to and from common destinations in the community, as well as to places like the Monon or other transit lines to connect up that system as well.
All right. Well, Mark and Joe, thank you for walking us through the slides. We have quite a few questions, so let me think about how I want to handle this here. Okay. I think there was a series of questions, as I'm trying to combine a few of them here, that we maybe touched on in the last webinar, but is worth bringing back up. And it really, the questions are centered around demographics and stakeholder groups that, this question is sort of, what we have today is working. We have a walkable, bikeable core with mix of uses. Who are the demographics that are really being attracted to the spaces where you can bike to work from home and live near where you work? I think even who is the audience for that office building in the adaptive reuse scenario? Like why are offices shifting in that direction? So I want you guys to touch on that for a moment. And then also, I get a sense of sort of this theme of, well, what if we were to just sit still, and have a core that's walkable and mixed use and an outer ring that's mostly residential, are there concerns there about not shifting and changing with these demographics that are starting to move to Carmel and raise their families in a different way than we've seen in the past?
So I can I can take a stab at that first question. So who is attracted to the, a business or office space on the Monon? I mean, I think if you ask a CEO or an HR director, a major component of where they bring a business is access to labor. Many of the workforce, at those nice new office buildings on the Monon, MJ Insurance, Allied Solutions, businesses like that, were in previously, many of them were in suburban office parks. And, attracting talent is really competitive business for them and core to their business. So they are, I think, following the lead of their new hires and the talent that they're trying to keep so that they can continue to grow and stay healthy. Really for offices to cluster downtown, in this case in Carmel around the Monon, or the, lovely public spaces and near the cultural amenities, is really how it's always occurred. It's not that the office parks, for instance, along 31 will ever go away. Indeed, Carr and Zotac and recent developments there prove that that is still a formula that works too. But Carmel has done both and is going to keep doing both and do it really well. It's really not even just a Carmel thing. Central Indiana, Carmel, just like Central Indiana, is competing nationally, frankly, for some of these businesses who can pick up and move. And, I think they're attracted to what Carmel's downtown is starting to look like. And I think they can feel confident that they'll be able to hold on to their talent. I think talking with the business community is maybe the answer to the first part of that question there. Another reason around why is, a comp plan does not decide, we need more commercial space or we need these housing units. The market is functioning. The real estate values are changing regardless of what the comp plan says. So I think the task is to shape and manage it in a way that's the best way possible. But, a lot of investment is coming to Carmel now and it will keep coming. So to keep things kind of as they are now would have to involve saying no to the next business. And it can be hard to stand still and still stay relevant. So I think it's more, how can we shape and manage the investment that's coming? Because Carmel's a wonderful place and wonderful places attract investment, and not saying, we're deciding what's coming here, because really the city doesn't have that role.
Well, and there's a link really between business and residents. I mean, so we're not just talking about businesses here. I have a couple of comments in the Q&A from people who have chosen recently to move to Carmel because they can be close to where they work and where they want to spend time, and they can get there in a car light, car free lifestyle. And it appears that these are families. These are folks who are moving in to raise their families here. So I think sometimes what gets lost in the conversation there is we cluster baby boomers and young professionals into one group and think that the growing families maybe are not in, they don't have those same needs. But I think that we're seeing that exists more and more today in Carmel, starting to serve that need. I do wanna, you mentioned the comp plan's role here, Mark. I think we'll probably do this on all four events, talk about what a comp plan can and cannot do. And its role in growth. You guys want to touch on that for a minute, particularly when it, I think one issue that always comes up is the difference between land use and zoning.
So the comprehensive plan, and Mark touched on this, and I think it's important to emphasize, is really a guide and management tool to acknowledge changes that have already taken place in the marketplace and in the community, and then put together smart goalposts for where the community wants to be in 5 to 10 years, without getting into the nuances and details of zoning and regulation. It may provide recommendations to study those tools further, but really it's a higher level vision document and goal setting document than a tool such as zoning. One of the things we're already starting to see in the 2008 document that preceded this update is that there were some cases where those lines got blurred, where certain things started to read quasi-regulation-y. And that needs to be clarified. And I think as we look to make updates and modifications and tweaks to that, I think we can further differentiate those two so that the roles of, say, a comprehensive plan and zoning are distinguished and clear.
Great. We do have a comment and or a question from Facebook, either I think it might be from a high school student, or it's at least about the high school, about the relationship between the one high school and the downtown core and how we're considering that when we think about the comp plan, particularly around mobility and students being able to get downtown from the school without getting in the car.
Yeah, I would zoom out just one click and talk about just how we connect to our schools in general. Are we doing everything we can to make it possible for faculty, staff, and students to roll out of their driveway or their front door and get to an elementary school or community neighborhood scaled school or even a high school safely and on time and in a predictable way without always relying on the bus, although the bus will continue to play an important role likely in the future. And so the first question we got to ask ourselves about our streets is, are we doing everything we can to make that a safe and predictable experience? And I think there's always work to be done on that front. Specific to the question about how do we connect downtown to the high school sits right along Main Street. As the crow flies, it's really close to a lot of great public spaces, the Monon Trail, as well as the types of amenities, services, distractions, fun things that, are open and welcoming of a student age population. And so really focusing in on what that connection is along Main Street, so that we're connecting an area where our faculty, staff, and students are focused for most of the day, and then how they can spill out of that and safely walk down the street, grab a cup of coffee at that coffee shop on Main Street, or even continue on into Midtown or the city center.
To continue that train of thought, as questions keep coming in here, we had a comment about it was one I mentioned earlier around moving to Carmel because we could live car light or car free and really enjoying the trails and the separated multi-use paths from the roads, which are Carmel's very rich in. But how are we thinking about on-street infrastructure to further connect the whole kind of system of multimodal non-car mobility? I feel like that applies to this high school conversation too.
Yeah, and the term complete streets gets thrown around a lot in planning circles. And I'm not sure Carmel historically thought of it in those terms, but over the last several decades, it has built hundreds of miles of complete streets with separated 12-foot or 10-foot multi-use paths from the moving traffic. As we start to think about the future, it is uneconomical both from a cost standpoint and a land utilization standpoint to think of putting broad boulevards to everybody's doorstep. It just doesn't work that way. That those work well to connect up the whole city, east to west, north to south, but there are finer grain connections. Again, going back to this idea of that last mile that connect people to and from these primary connections to where they're going or from where they're coming from. And that's where, finer grain, more economical use of the street, where cars can be managed at a much slower speed, where we can start mixing and bringing into closer proximity walkers, bike riders, scooters, all the other users of the street in closer proximity to the car, which is going slower. That's where those types of facilities start to make sense. Specific to the on-street bike infrastructure, this is already being tested on streets such as Rangeline. where you're getting a more economical use of existing pavements that are no longer necessary for vehicular traffic and using those for moderate to experienced cyclists. I think it's important in a family-friendly place like Carmel that still has a lot of automobile-oriented use of its streets to not think about them as either or, but as additive elements to an interconnected system.
Mark, shifting gears a minute and put some pressure on you here, was asked about what growth projections might look like for the next 20 years for Carmel. And she was specifically asking about what that would mean for how we think about parks in public space. But can you, at the risk of being dangerous, start to give some guesstimates on that based on what we already know?
And we're gonna hold you to this, by the way.
Yeah, we're gonna come back in 20 years.
Yeah,
play this video.
So generally our timeline for this plot process is the next 10 years. You know, of course, everything doesn't stop in 2030, 2031, but you know, the further you look out beyond 10 years gets to become eventually a fool's errand because, you know, generational shifts will have occurred. So 10 years, roughly our time frame. You know, part of our task here was not a specific population projection effort. You know, a lot of the topics we mentioned today around adaptability and resiliency are making sure that whatever happens with the birth rate, with immigration rates, with live work patterns, what's more important is that Carmel should be here and be healthy, you know, in a century. Because one day, you know, we'll be comp planning again in a century and doing the same kind of looks back to see what worked, you know, what needed shifting, and which of these buildings or public uses, you know, still weathered or, you know, could be useful all throughout Carmel's history. So we're certainly looking in the next 5 years out is much easier to think about. I don't have a number off the top of my head for what we're assuming, but I think recent trends have made it clear that the basically building out of the large tracts of farmland has not meant the end of growth, and infill, I think, or finding leftover spaces will continue to be rethought of and reutilized. So I think, you know, growth can and should be in Carmel's future, but we don't have a hard and concrete number right now.
Yeah. We have about 7 minutes left, so I wanna make sure we have enough time to wrap. I just wanna end on, I have a few questions on transit. One asks, how will the comp plan address bus train routes to and from other cities such as Fishers or Indianapolis? Before you answer that, just kind of a piggyback question on how do you maintain pedestrian friendly walkability, bikeability streets while also growing mass transit? Joe, do you want to take a stab at one of those first?
Sure, I'll answer the second one first, because I think it's a really important one and picks up on a lot of the themes that we've brought up today around how design of both our buildings and our neighborhoods, as well as our streets and public spaces, really starts to matter even more so as we start to think about a world where we're moving in and not out. And so when you think about accommodating a transit vehicle, there's two primary perspectives to keep in mind. One is the user of the transit and why it would be a viable and preferable option for that user to get on the vehicle in the first place. To do that, it's got to be safe, convenient, and at travel at rates that are competitive with the alternative. And so to accomplish that, oftentimes transit is premium transit, the kind that we would imagine at one day would be in Carmel's future, needs to have some amount of preference in the right-of-way so that when I'm making a choice between driving and hopping on a transit vehicle, for instance, I know that if I get on the transit vehicle, I can keep up or even move quicker than the corresponding vehicles on the road. So that it becomes a design challenge within a constrained right-of-way of a street, for instance, what amount of space we're going to give to the transit vehicle and what amount of space we're going to give to everybody else. Regardless of the case, what we often advise is that if you design from the inside out, meaning designing for the pedestrian and the human user of the street first, and then work your way out, that will work best for all modes of travel. Mark, do you want to handle the kind of regional connectivity issue? No question?
Sure. Kevin, do you mind restating that part of the question for me?
Sure. I think essentially what he's getting at is, and Mark, you're based out of Indianapolis, you have a good read on the regional plans for transit. How can the comp plan help put Carmel in the driver's seat, pun intended, for how to make sure they're involved and this drives their involvement in those regional plans? That's how I'm reading the question.
Yeah, I mean, I think Carmel is doing it by investing in the core. You know, transit supportive density is what Carmel's doing now, whether or not transit ever comes. You know, transit oriented development is just people oriented development that may one day have transit. And, you know, who knows what the future of the Red Line is specifically. Certainly in a growing city, though, the way we get around is going to change. It is changing. You know, and what mode that takes remains to be seen. You know, I think for Central Indiana in general to remain competitive for job growth and relevancy, you know, here on the national stage is to make sure that our job centers, you know, kind of the many centers of this region are connected meaningfully. And, you know, I think an example, you know, one zone, the Chamber of Commerce for Fishers and Carmel is a nice example, but also, you know, when Indianapolis, when Central Indiana pursued, you know, the Amazon HQ2, we have to be thinking as a region and regionally in terms of these major transportation investments and focusing job growth and aligning workforce efforts and everything else. So I think making a compelling case as a great place to invest and live is certainly Carmel's role that they've, you know, done well. And, you know, continuing to do that, keeping an eye on how their role fits within the rest of the region will help make sure that, you know, they can continue to be a leader and help lead the rest of the region and really the state and, you know, how to stay competitive.
I think before we close down, Kevin, I think another thing that's important that the comprehensive plan can do specific to mobility and transit is to inform and shape policy and priorities relative to, I'll call it capital T transit, you know, fixed guideway or heavy transit like buses and BRT, bus rapid transit that connects Carmel to the region. I think another more important and maybe more immediately implementable way that the comprehensive plan can shape how we move around is informing the conversation around kind of choice for how we move around within the city. On the slide that we talked about transit, there were a couple images of six passenger golf carts that travel at 20 miles an hour or 25 miles an hour. In several communities that we're working, this is becoming that low hanging fruit that allows you know, either third party services or city services or nonprofit services to actually operate these vehicles throughout the city. Connecting people to common destinations or throughout a large restaurant or shopping district, or connect neighborhoods to places like parks, community centers, schools, and the urban core. So that kind of decision-making can really be informed by a comprehensive plan. In addition to some of the other things that we've talked around, bikes, pedestrian friendliness, scooters can oftentimes make their way into that conversation. Who's managing those, who's providing that kind of service, and how do they safely occupy the right of way? All gets teed up in a comprehensive plan.
All right. Thanks, Joe. Thanks, Mark. Our one last comment was, I like the golf carts. So I'm glad we took an extra minute there.
Me too.
Well, and we do have, there were some questions and comments we didn't get to, some around engagement, how to stay involved. Keep an eye on the project website for that, communicate with the city, et cetera. And we'll make sure we do our best to get those answered. Thank you guys for joining us today. We appreciate you taking your Friday lunch break with us. As I mentioned previously, this is just the second of four Talk of the Town events. The next one is 2 weeks from today on March 26th, same time, same bat channel. And the topic for that will be complementary growth. And since you have registered for this webinar, you should be automatically registered for the next event, so you'll get a reminder. If you think of comments or questions after we finished, if you're hanging out today and you start thinking back on one of the slides and you have a comment or a question, head over to the website, Facebook, YouTube, the main project page, and leave comments and questions. And please keep an eye out for the recorded version of today's discussion. We'll be posting that on the website, YouTube, et cetera. Please, if you do see that, share it on your social media feed, email it to your friends and neighbors. We want as many people to join us as possible. Thank you again for joining us, and we'll see you in a couple weeks. Have a great weekend, everybody.